was once, a long time ago, a US president who had a vision for the world and for the worlds beyond. It's not just about those who can't see beyond their immediate issues, it's about those who saw the big futures ahead. And exactly 56 years ago, on the 25th of May, 1961, John Kennedy made a speech to both houses of representatives in the United States, the Senate and Congress, where he committed the US to going to find a way to get a man to the moon. Now, I was young enough, and so were you, to remember that moment in 1968 when a man first landed on the moon and made that incredible statement, as Buzz Aldrin did, that this is one small step for a man, one big step for mankind. Buzz Aldrin died just a month ago. Kennedy, of course, didn't live to see the promise that he made, and every scientist around Kennedy at the time had no idea how to do it. In fact, nobody in NASA had any idea how to do it, and the fascinating thing was every scientist in the US told him not to promise it. But he had a vision that was big enough to capture America and to go for other worlds, and we know what happened. That was a president in his speech who made this statement. He says, "We choose to do these things not because they are easy, but because they are hard. This will require all the energy of America's minds to focus to get the outcome." And I want to help you to get towards an outcome in the course of these next 20 minutes, which focuses your mind beyond brain bar. And when you go back into the normality of life with all the things that have buzzed around you in the course of the last couple of days, I hope that you'll have an overriding conviction for whatever company or organization you're working with or wherever you are as an individual, that you will hold this template of promises agreed between the nations of the world, not disavowed by any one of them, and the leading corporations of the world to fulfill a promise that we only have 13 years left to achieve. The Sustainable Development Goals fundamentally are about breaking this problem, inequality. Mark Zuckerberg, who everybody knows founded Facebook and has, of course, made a great fortune from it, delivered what's called the commencement speech at Harvard last Thursday. And he addresses two problems in his speech. One is whether or not people who go to great universities, who come to places like Brain Bar, people who think that they're the intellectuals of the next generation, are they the kind of people who've got enough vision to work together to achieve exactly what these Sustainable Development Goals set out to achieve? Can they actually combine their energy and effort to get to a point where there is no hunger, zero hunger, or we don't actually have decent work, number eight, and economic growth, or life below water is protected and not full of plastics? And then he goes on to say, at the heart of solving this is dealing with the problem of inequality. And he proposes in dealing with the problem of inequality, not bashing the billionaires, because that isn't going to get us anywhere. But what he actually says is we have to be prepared to raise the poorest people in the world, to be prepared to pay the difference, not for the cheap clothing we want to get or the cheap food we want to get or the cheap conveniences we want to get, but actually to pay more for the water and the facilities and the clothing and the food to make sure that those who are the producers at the bottom of the line, they get the opportunity for a quality of living that most of us desperately want and have. We are, as most people would feel, part of the 99%. That great mass who feel somehow it's just unfair. And you can, if you like, protest endlessly about the 1% versus the 99%. We can all come out onto the streets and make huge effort and noise, but the huge effort and noise doesn't necessarily get us anywhere than turning some people into aggressors about those who are different. The go-home movement, which was so typical of the elections in the US, of the Brexit questions in the UK, of the Austrian presidential elections, which ran twice, as you know, of the Dutch elections, of the French elections, and forthcoming in September of the German elections, this great go-home message for so many is the answer to the world's inequality, but it's no answer at all. It is simply to embed division. And that embedding of division and anger achieves nothing. So we need something of the big Kennedy vision, which is actually to say, I've no idea how to achieve it, but I'm going to get every possible energy together to draw upon in order that it can be achieved. It's going to take people in corporations, people in NGOs, people in government, people in academia, people with big ideas willing to work together to achieve those sustainable development goals. And yes, even people who wrap themselves in the flag of nationalism, who want to opt out of great big commitments, but watch the reaction since the announcement on Thursday. What has happened? America's businesses have bonded together. America's cities have bonded together. America's states have bonded together. And leaders from every corner of the world have said, we will fulfill the detail of the Paris Agreement. You can do what you like in the White House, but we'll do what is right and responsible. But that voice is not just a voice of protest. It's a voice of practicability. Michael Bloomberg committing just this morning that if necessary, he will fund and seek to raise the funds necessary to fulfill all the federal obligations of the US government alongside those of states and cities. So, what are the uncomfortable realities that we've got to square up to? Well, I don't need to tell you, those of you Hungarians and anyone coming from Eastern Europe, what this stuff has been all about, because you've seen it. It's passed through your borders. You've been a transit country here in Hungary. I'm sure you've seen people in Budapest. I visited in Stockholm just 2 years ago and watched a large number of migrants who've come all the way up across, many of them Syria, others who'd come through Afghanistan, literally living on the streets of Stockholm. But I also went to Lebanon to visit in the refugee camps in Lebanon to see the people directly displaced as a consequence of the Syrian war. People who are just looking for ordinary, decent opportunity to refulfill their lives, to shape their lives again, once based on the promise that they had that life would be fair, until it wasn't fair. And this picture finally caused the leaders of Europe to say, it's about time we stopped dismissing the issue and we got engaged. And so solutions began to be framed, but you know as well as I do that those solutions were only really about containing and holding people back rather than saying, how do we intervene to prevent the problem in the first place? The hard numbers are deeply uncomfortable. It's one thing to be a migrant who wants to move to another country because you want to create a new life for yourself, and we should always support and facilitate that. It's quite another thing, block three, to be trapped in a refugee camp for 17 years, the average, meaning some people are trapped for over 20 years to 25 years. It's one thing to actually decide that you choose a country for your children or a university for your children. It's quite another thing to find there is no place of education at all and the only place is a camp on the floor. It is our responsibility to take it seriously, to require of our governments much more, but to be willing to do what many people have chosen to do. And I have to say the model example would be those in Canada and Germany who've chosen to embrace the needs and the opportunities and the challenges of refugees and migrants by opening their own homes to willingly take people in. Not just to simply say the system doesn't work, but what do I do to respond to the needs of the system? Let's look at this challenge.
Thank you.
So you're going to go the whole way or stick with the halfway? Loss was achieved by 2015. Poverty was cut in half. Starvation was cut in half. All of those things were wonderful, but you're going to stick there and be happy with that? We're going to get the whole way. 13 more years to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And it's got to be all of us, between companies and academics and individuals and university leaders and people in NGOs and government. We've all got to work on this ambition together. And if there's one thing all of us can do, there is a simple option, which we in KPMG have decided that we will actively do. It is the choice to support lifelong learning. Because here's the simple thing every individual can do, which is to pass on the power of learning and literacy to another. Frederick Douglass, who was the great American abolitionist from the 1900s, from the 1800s, he said that if you really, really, really want to set the slave free, you teach them how to read, empower them how to write, and place them in a place where they can make their own choices. Carl Sager, the scientist, 100 years later, said that he agreed with Frederick Douglass's comment that actually the most important thing the world could ever gift to anyone is the power of literacy. That's why we think this is such a fundamental necessity. Watch this. That video is from a really cool organization. It's called the World Bank. And the World Bank says that the most important tool for equipping a new generation to be able to grab the brain power of the future, to work with artificial intelligence, to be digital entrepreneurs, to make a change in the world that matters, is to provide quality education. And guess what? Every adult who can read can teach 10 people who can't. It's not about professionalism. It's all about time, giftedness, willingness to engage. Just quickly cast your eye over these stunning statistics. 758 million people in the world unable to read and write. How will they grab the artificial intelligence digital future? How will they do that? Just look at this. Without the resources that in the brain and the mind, how will they ever be part of a vivid economy? They will only ever be locked out. And what will they do? Further entrench the protest movements, which have been all about the 99% and the 1%. So corporate culture is changing. There've been a crisis of trust. Some companies get it wrong. We all have difficulties if you work for a big company. Let's not pretend we're sorted and perfect, but those who seek to get it right, and I honor them for doing so, many of them on this board, one doesn't exist anymore, but the rest of them did their best once it's gone wrong. Big companies are beginning to become the boom of the now. Once it was all about manufacturing, now it's about relationships and knowledge. And Fortune magazine decided a few years ago, 2 years ago, that they would chart the companies that are changing the world. Not just those who were making money. And guess who came out top? No, not KPMG, Vodafone. But Vodafone came out top because they created M-Pesa, the money transfer system that allows the poorest people in the world to exchange resources with one another, empowers the unbanked to be bankable. Unilever, with its massive commitment to empower 1 billion people to have quality lives. Pearson's, with their commitment to literacy. And our KPMG, with our commitment to building villages in the world and communities that nobody would ever know that we were part of, but simply because it matters on a basis of human dignity. These sustainable development goals are your opportunity, your challenge, and my duty. But I see it as only one thing possible. Join the fight. Thank you. That's our objective.
I don't know where to start. You give me so many thoughts. Having, as I did in the intro, sort of similar education, I had the benefit, dubious benefit, of 7 years of Latin. And I often, politely, I hope, remind people of what the word education actually means, which is drawing out. It's something that we can go and knock on your door and say, yeah, I'm here to help.
Well, I hope everybody here will do one of three things. First of all, they will go on to the Global Citizen website and they will join up as a citizen who's prepared to follow up on campaigns, to pressure their politicians, to pressure their corporations and businesses, and to get involved actively in local activism, which Global Citizen will give them. I think that's step number one. Everyone can do that. Step number two is we're all teachers. Everybody here who has a child knows that actually we teach them our accent. We teach them our words, we teach them our moods, we teach them our behaviors. We can teach children how to read from reading to children in the womb. It's the most important thing any adult can possibly do. And if we can do it for our own children, why don't we make a choice to work with those who are caught in NGO relationship groups, whether it's refugee camps or it's in supported charities, where we get involved actively in developing the education of younger children. That's step number two. And step number three, which is really important about this stuff, 13 years left to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. So this is not a one-year project. This is not something I'm going to do for a couple of weeks. This has got to be a commitment. Now, you and I roughly went to school around the same time. I'm a couple of years older than you. I mean, look at my hair. But, you know, the thing is, I've been about this since I've been 16, and I'm now 60. And I'm absolutely determined that I want to be there at the end of the Sustainable Development Goals for the next commitments to make sure that we do that most fundamental thing of all, to give dignity to those who don't have it, to end extreme poverty and hunger, to provide sanitation and toilets for those that have electricity for those who can't switch on lights, and to give fair justice for those who are outside of it. And it needs the companies like KPMG, who are willing to do it, put our back to this work, but it needs everybody in the company to absolutely bother their bosses, like our people bother their bosses. And so we put ourselves forward for this global reading program. We've now got it actively in 12 countries, and we're now going to move it on to another 19. And what we're doing is getting our people to do this reading with refugee children, getting our people to do reading with primary school children, getting our people to do reading with people from disadvantaged communities. And up to now, in the course of just 5 years, we've done 3 million direct book placements. Yes, an audit firm has worked directly with 3 million children in 7 countries initially, where we provided them with reading materials and worked to help them to get to read, and sticking with them until they do so. And it's gone from our chairman all the way through our executive, right the way down to the youngest person in the firm. So it's everybody's duty to join this fight, to do what Frederick Douglass said, give the best gift you can ever give to somebody who's enslaved. And people are enslaved because they're poor, or they're refugees, or they're outside of the economy, or they don't feel they can participate. So modern slavery is a different form. Yet there are still people entrapped physically, but they're entrapped sometimes because their minds are dark, and we need to open their minds.